Testing 1, 2. Okay. Now that my mic is on, I welcome you this evening to the Wednesday Word and Praise Service at our Savior's First Lutheran Church here in Granada Hills, California. Whether you're here in person or you're watching via Facebook or YouTube, each of us have one thing in common with the other. We all come this evening not as obedient children of our Creator, but as insubordinate individuals in need of God's mercy, forgiveness, and grace. And just as we wash our hands before eating, we now begin our worship by remembering our baptism in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty Father, we come to worship you with souls and lives that are soiled with sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's all read this prayer aloud. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. And I have good news for you this evening. Your relationship with the Lord has been restored through the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Therefore, as a called servant of the Lord, I announce that all your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. One of the New Testament's most wonderful examples of God's concern and love for the repentant sinner can be found in Jesus' parable of the prodigal son. This evening, as we sing our first song, put yourself in the singer's place. Understand her words of personal sinfulness and unworthiness are also yours and mine. As we came to worship God in repentance, God the Father lifts us up and forgives us through the grace of his one and only Son, sacrificed for us so that we might be called his son or daughter. Let's now sing the goodness of God.
Thank you.
1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. God has ordained that those who practice righteousness instead of practicing lawlessness to take a stand as God's children. 1 John 3. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are. The reason why the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, because we shall see him as he is. And everyone who thus hopes in him purifies himself as he is pure. Everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he appeared to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him keeps on sinning. No one who keeps on sinning has either seen him or know him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Whoever practices righteousness is righteous, as he is righteous. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And in reverence now for the gospel, please stand up for God's good news. Our gospel for this evening is from Luke chapter 24, verses 36 through 49. Glory to you, O Lord. In the scripture reading, we will see that Jesus bids us to take a stand with full assurance in the reliability of the scriptures and the resurrection. Luke 24. As they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be to you." But they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. And he said to them, "Why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and my feet. That is I, myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it before them. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "Thus it is written, that the Christ should suffer on the third day, rise from the dead, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins should be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning from Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. And behold, I am sending the promise of my Father upon you, but stay in the city until you are clothed with powers on high." This is the holy gospel of the Lord. Praise be you, O Christ. Please be seated and join in singing our sermon hymn, "In Christ Alone."
My comforter, my all in
stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground, his body lay, tight of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's cursed has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. Built of life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first breath to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns and calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. May the words of my mouth and my thoughts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my sheltering rock and my redeemer. It's time to stand. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns and calls me home. Here in the power of Christ, I stand. On Sunday, April 18th, our pastor, Casey Jenks, in honor of the 500th anniversary, presented a short summary of what Martin Luther said in response to the papal decree commanding Luther to renounce his writings that conflicted with Roman Catholic dogma. Luther said in his response to that demand, "Unless I am convinced by the testimony of scriptures or by clear reason, I am bound by the scriptures I have quoted, and my conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot and will not recant anything, since it is neither safe nor right to go against conscience. Here I stand. I can do no other. May God help me. Amen." In short, Luther said, "Here in the power of Christ, I will stand." He said it. He said it was time for him to take a stand, firm in what he had discovered to be true. That is, trusting in God alone, through Christ alone, as found in the scriptures alone. Now, this was not the first time in history that a servant of the one true God had to take a stand against someone who would deny God's truth. Most of us remember the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. It was a time when Babylon had conquered Israel and carried the riches of Jerusalem, including the healthiest of its people, into captivity. The king Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon heard of their disobedience to his decree, and he asked them, "Is it true, O Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the golden image that I have set up? If you do not worship, you shall immediately be cast into a burning, fiery furnace. And who is the God who will deliver you out of my hands?" Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king. They said, well, first of all, they took a stand. Right there and then, they said to the king, "O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this be so, our God, whom we serve, is able to deliver us out of the fiery, burning furnace. And he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. But if not, be it known to you, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the golden image that you have set up." Those three young men took a stand against a law that was ungodly. They were sure of what scriptures had taught them. They trusted in God's promise that they would be kept safe, if not in this life, then in the next. And God did keep them safe. Now Daniel also stood up to the authorities of his time. He refused to follow a royal decree that banned any type of prayer or worship other than to the king. Knowing the king's law was not as important as God's, Daniel took a stand. He took a stand by kneeling and continuing to pray. And the Lord delivered him from the consequences of his crime against the state. But not after Daniel spent a night in a den full of hungry lions. In the Acts of the Apostles, we also can find an example after example of Christians standing firm on the authority of scriptures and of the resurrection. In Acts, we find Peter and John. They had to stand before the council in Jerusalem. They were told to stop speaking or teaching in the name of Jesus. Their response to that order was, "Do you think God wants us to obey you rather than him? We cannot stop telling everything that we have seen and heard." It was their time to take a stand against intolerance and to stand up for the truth. And so it has continued through the centuries leading to the present. Christians are to stand up for the truth of the gospel at all times and in all places, secure in knowing that our empowerment comes from God alone. For he has granted to us all that is needed for us to stand against the evil of this world. For it is written in the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, that we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, we are to use what God has supplied for us. We are to take up our whole armor of God, so we will be able to withstand the evil day that is upon us, and having done all, to stand firm. And then Paul describes each item of armor we will need to put on. He starts with the belt of truth. For we are to speak only what we know to be the truth. For the truth secures all things that we say and do, keeping us from tripping over our own words or actions. We are also to put on the breastplate of righteousness. For the righteousness of Christ shields our heart from danger. Then there are the shoes for our feet, enabling us to walk in the gospel of peace. We are then to take up the shield of faith. That shield will protect us from the attacks of the evil one. And when we stand up, we are guarded from doubting God's promises by putting on the helmet of salvation, reminding us that we are saved by faith in Christ alone. Then, when we are fully equipped with God's armor, we are finally ready to pick up the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, the Bible, and the only weapon we'll need to strike the enemy down and kill his lies. And thus, we stand, praying in all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. Those words of God written by Paul focus us on the true enemy of Christ, who is our enemy too, and it offers an itemized list of all of God's gracious provisions. Now, long ago, Peter wrote to us in this present age. He wrote, "Now, even if we should suffer for righteousness' sake, we need to remember that we will be blessed by our Lord. We are to have no fear, nor are we to be troubled, but in our hearts regard Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks us for a reason for the hope that is in us. And we are to do this with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when we are slandered, not if, but when we are slandered, we will be able to show others that our good behavior in Christ is not something to be put to shame. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that should be God's will, than to suffer for doing evil." Through the redeeming work of our Christ, you, the Christian, are not of this world. However, you are in this world. You are in this world to temper the effects of sin on God's creation. You are here to take a stand, to challenge the progression of godlessness that you may find in your home, in your neighborhood, at your workplace, by professing the truth about sin and through showing the power of the resurrection in your words and your actions. For greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Let us pray. We pray to you, Father, for now is the time to stand up for your Son, Jesus. Prepare us with what we need to share the good news of the resurrection with those who need your grace and forgiveness in their lives. Empower us by your Holy Spirit to be bold in our sharing and kind in our concern for those who are lost. Help us to remember our own sinfulness so that we will not appear conceited or arrogant. Implant in us the type of love you have for the sinner. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And now let's pray for the whole church of God in Christ Jesus, and all for all people according to their needs. Lord God, in your presence we find fullness of joy, and by your right hand, Christ Jesus, you win and deliver peace forevermore in the midst of this world's sins and sorrows. Give us peace in the knowledge of his salvation and confident hope in the resurrection of the dead. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Heavenly Father, by the incarnation of your Son and the reconciliation on his cross, you have made us your children and gathered us into your holy church. Sustain the preaching of your holy word and its message of repentance for the forgiveness of sins in Jesus' name, among us and all the nations of the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Give peace, Lord, to our homes and enliven them by Christ's resurrected life. Let the forgiveness of sins reign among the husband and the wives, parents and children. Assure those who live alone that they too are your children, upheld in your right hand. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, preserve our nation and its leaders, especially Joseph, our president, and Gavin, our governor. Preserve order and decency in this fallen world by their hands, and restrain the sins and deceptions of lawlessness, that we may practice righteousness while awaiting the eternal peace promised in Christ's wounds alone. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious Father, as your Son's wounds brought gladness and peace to the troubled disciples, give your presence and comfort to the troubled in our midst. Comfort those also who weep with the blessed joy of Easter morning. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. All these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever. Amen. And now, Lord, we stand up to rejoice as we pray in the wondrous words that you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy will be done, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as you forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. As you notice today, I'm doing the service by myself with the help of the audio and technical crew. And I thank you, Lord, for sending them to me. And I'm sorry for the times I forgot to turn on my microphone. It was all right here, right on my belt. But I forgot to do that a couple of times. You notice I'm here alone. Like I said, Ross Hartman, our elder, is off on a business trip right now. He'll be returning to us for Sunday's service. So it'll be good to see him then. I'm here alone, but not alone, because where two or more gathered in my name, Jesus said, there I am in the midst of them. So he's been here too. One thing to remind you of is 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings is our worship service led by Casey Jenks, Pastor Casey Jenks. You're all invited to attend. Please come also with your mask and be prepared to practice social distancing as we're still going through the pandemic. And we will be here again on Wednesday at 7 o'clock for our Word and Praise service. You are invited to attend and bring your friends too. And if you are able to, and we wish you would, please get in contact with us through one of these email addresses that you see up here. And let us know how we can minister to you or if you have any prayer requests or concerns. And with that in mind, with prayer requests and concerns, why don't we rise up for a blessing from the Lord? And like I used to tell my students when I was the spiritual life director at L.A. Lutheran Concordia High School, that when you are blessed by the Lord, don't squander that blessing. Don't keep it for yourself. Share it with others so that others may know of God's blessings. And so now, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance and give you his peace. And all God's children said, amen. Now, stay standing. And if you're able to sing a victory song, then you're going to sing this one. This is going to be singing a victory song. It's called Stand Up for Jesus. Now, the whole thing is, we've got the music for that. But it's going to be your voices that only can be heard. So you're standing up for Jesus like all good Christians should. So let's sing together now, Stand Up for Jesus. We'll start with the second stanza, the second time it's played, as you hear the melody. Here we are. Stand up for Jesus. Stand up for Jesus, ye soldiers of the cross. Lift high his royal banner, it has not suffered loss. From victory unto victory, his army shall we lead. Till every foe is vanquished, and Christ is Lord indeed. Stand up for Jesus, the trumpet call obey. Stand forth in mighty conflict in this his glorious day. Let all his faithful serve him against unnumbered foes. Let courage rise from danger and strength to strength oppose. Stand up for Jesus, stand in his strength alone. The arm of flesh will fail you, you dare not trust your own. Put on the gospel armor, each piece put on with prayer. Where duty calls or danger, be never wanting there. Stand up for Jesus, the strife will not be long. This day the din of battle, the next the victor's song. The soldiers overcoming, their crown of life shall see. And with the King of glory shall reign eternally. Amen. Go with peace to serve the Lord.